All right, High Rollers, great to be back for another Darts Chat. His bio reads sports, fitness, and recreation, but it should read darts, football, and politics. I sometimes find myself asking, what would Darts Twitter be without this guy? Forget heartthrob. I think he's my dart throb. I learned that term today watching Players Championship 15. Oche Balboa, the Rocky of darts, throws punches in bunches, and I'm sure we're in for a few haymakers today. Chris, welcome back, my friend. Thanks for being our high roller.
All right, thank you very much for having me on.
You put out a tweet this morning about James Wade, who, of course, reached the semifinals on the weekend in Leverkusen, but withdrew to illness, wasn't feeling well, got checked out by medics, and was advised to go to the hospital where he still is. Symptoms including racing heart, high blood pressure, nausea, and dizziness. Scary times, right?
Very much so. That is quite worrying, considering he's like, 38, 39? And he's suffering from that. He may just be one of those things that happened at the time or anything, but it just goes to show that sometimes darts players may need to relax their schedule because of the travelling and what they're doing, their lifestyle, everything like that. So it's a worrying time for him, and I hope he gets better soon.
Yeah, I want more thoughts on the subject because you did put out that tweet. A lot is expected of these players today, especially the top pros.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you look at some of the schedule and you just scratch your head and you think, what the hell? They play the Premier League. They play 1 to 3 matches in the Premier League. Then they get ready and go to the European Tour, which they may play on the Friday night if they're not a seed. And then for the Saturday. So it's just like non-stop living out of a suitcase, travelling all the way there. Yes, the rewards are good. And yes, they are handsomely paid and fair play to them because they're very, very good darts players and all that. But it can come at a loss with your mental health, with your physical health, with things like that. It's just sometimes managers and themselves have to sit down and probably think, shall we lessen this? Because people are worried about losing their places, going down one place in the world rankings, for example, or losing their place in the European Championships or the Players' Championships. And you've got to think, well, you're good enough to play. You don't have to play everything. So I think juggling it, like they're doing this week, a lot of the Premier League players have opted out, which I think is a good idea. I think things will come good for everybody, but this may be a wake-up call they need.
I think we have to be honest about this. I remember interviewing Daryl Gurney, and he admittedly, quite frank, he was joking, but he did say that darts is not a healthy sport. And it's got so big nowadays with all the travel that you just alluded to. It really takes a toll on the player. And let's be honest, there's alcohol involved for some of these guys. Most of them, perhaps, I don't know. But it is not a healthy sport at times. You add the travel, all the high pressure, it just adds up.
Yeah, and you can add like things like fast foods because it's easy to grab like chips on the way to the hotel or grab a McDonald's or KFC, and that builds up as well. So, you know, people just got to, it's just all about work, but it's all about dart imbalance and their lifestyles, really. And I think that's a wake-up call for everybody in society, really. But, yeah, it needs to be looked at.
It's probably hard to sleep on the road, too.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I did 3 days at Lakeside, and I found that knackering. So they're used to it, obviously. But imagine if they're doing it for like 250 days of the year. It's grueling and it's hard.
Where is darts with other sports? Forgive the ignorance on this, but you know, in other big time sports, the players have managers, a whole team, an entourage, if you will, around them, and a lot of their travel, their scheduling is planned. Is that happening in darts today?
I would imagine so, because I think the managers will take care of a lot of stuff. You know, they got people that work for their team, you know, do their tweets and stuff. And I imagine they'll sort out their hotels, their traveling and everything like that. But they still have to physically go and travel, you know, and go to this event, go to that event and everything like that. I'm not saying that managers are working darts players a lot. I don't think that's true. But I think sometimes maybe a week's rest here or there will help players. I mean, Anderson, for his own reasons, doesn't do the European Tour. So I think that helps him with his family life. Because don't forget, these blokes have got families. So people got to take into consideration of that. And darts fans as well need to take that into consideration when they moan about certain players not entering certain events. And they think, well, you know, it's because they don't need to. And secondly, it's because family is more important sometimes. So and people go look at that as well.
On the topic of James Wade and the all-time top 10 darts players, you had some back and forth recently on Twitter on the subject. Where do you have James Wade, and who are your top 10 exactly? I mean, let's start with Phil Taylor, Eric Bristow, MVG, or is it Phil Taylor, MVG, Eric Bristow? I've got Eric Bristow number two, but I just love the guy.
Yes. I don't have James Wade in my top 10, quite simply because he hasn't won the World Championship.
Okay, so that explains it then. I was wondering why you were taking all this flack on Twitter. So many responses, you know, comparing James Wade to RVB, all these things, and you were taking some heat, my man.
Oh, yes, I was. It's all good. It's all good-natured, really. I mean, I call the lads, the young lads, the lad Bible lads, and they take it in good things. They're a good bunch of lads, like Josh and Brian Wallace and all those guys. They're all right. But they're wrong about Wade being, and about Barney. Barney is the third or fourth. I'm not quite sure with him and MVG, best player of all time. I think Bristow is second. And I think the rest of them, it's like Lowe, Wilson, Adams, Bob Anderson, Gary Anderson, and I think Peter Wright's just outside it. So it's a good debate. Sometimes you may think it's different eras where you think, well, a certain player wouldn't have won that if he was in that field or whatever, but that's just all a bit. It's all if buts and maybes, but probably the best idea is to compare eras. And have top 10 of eras, like top 10 of the last 15 years versus the top 10 of the previous 15 years or something like that. But it's always a good debate and everybody joins in and it's all good laugh, really.
You know, on the topic of best all time, when it comes to Jockey Wilson and Gary Anderson and Scotland, Peter Wright in there as well, I've got Jockey Wilson at the top. Again, I'm a huge fan of the guy. I take heat for that because, you know, Gary Anderson's so good, especially in the free flow. But come on, Jockey, absolute legend.
Jockey is a legend, and I'll put him above Gary Anderson just on the basis of that he was one of the originals. He had the throw, which nobody really understood, but he still won things. And Anderson is very, very good, and he still is very, very good, and has been very good for, 15 years? So he's got more longevity than Wilson to a degree. So, again, I'll put Wilson in because of more of a legend status than Gary Anderson, but Gary Anderson isn't that far away from him, really.
You know, I can hang on to that claim because they both have two world championships. Back to James Wade, he hasn't got one. If he should get one in the next year, two, three, five, is he on that list of yours?
He may be. He may be. I'm not 100% sure. He's got to win it for me to evaluate the position. But there's no doubt about it. James Wade's a very good player. I mean, he's been in the top 10 for 14 years. So it just shows you that he's always sticking around. He's always sticking around. And you have people like Taylor retiring, Barney, they perform retiring and going to poker school and doing nothing after that and so forth. So you got all that. But Wade's in the 11 to 20. No doubt about that, but not top 10.
I'll be honest, at one point, James Wade, I was not a fan of his simply because of the way he acted on stage. But because of another Twitter follower, at the Hammer Wheels, he sort of changed my mind. And I'll tell you what, I like the way he plays. I like his demeanor up there. He kind of plays with a chip on his shoulder, right? And if you can look at it that way, you can appreciate it.
Oh, yeah. I think he's a very complex or strange guy, really. I think the best way to describe him, I listen to his interviews, and I think he treats Phil Barnes with disdain, which is quite funny. But he's very complex, and he's somebody, in my opinion, who it's take or leave it. Really, I'm not really that fussed by him. I don't really want him to lose, or not really that bothered about him winning. He's like one of those players for me.
Well, let's keep rocking and rolling with our theme, shall we? James Wade and the Premier League. Now, as far as I know, Wade is having a pretty good Premier League, but I can't really tell you that for sure because I haven't been watching. Is the Premier League having a good Premier League?
I haven't watched much of it either. I'm the same. I've not liked the format one bit. I thought it would work, and I was in the maybe it would work camp, but it only works for the people that turn up to the venue and they can have a tournament in a night time. You know, tournaments in a night where they can have a good old a drunken piss up. So you got that. But I just think it's very repetitive. I was just like, when is it going to end? I was thinking it's only week 12. Thank you, God. I've not watched too much of it live. I've watched some of the highlights here and there. I'll watch finishes and I'll see, watch the big, you know, the finals and stuff like that on YouTube and so forth and all that. But I've not watched much of it, and I don't like the format. And I wasn't a fan of the previous format, so it's probably one of those things for me. It's just that I'm a bit, it's one of those things for me. I'm not, I mean, people say it's like top eight in the world are playing each other every week, and I'm just like, yeah, great. I'm not really that fussed. We had Wade and Van Gerwen 5 times in 6 weeks. I'd rather these matches build up into something of suspense rather than playing each other every week. And it just, and I don't know. And it's not for me, really. They're not doing it to cater for me. They're doing it to cater for people who go into the arenas and people, you know, the fair-weather casual fans who probably enjoy it more. So Premier League's not really for me, but there you go.
Well, the format certainly needs changing. What are you recommending? 16 players? And let's go one step further. Are we past the need for a Premier League? Why not just define 4 majors and make them all really, really, really huge?
Yes, we're stepping onto another thing now, which everybody likes talking about, is what defines a major. The Premier League isn't a major, it's an exhibition, so that goes without saying. But I think the Premier League would work better if it was 16 players. You have eight on 1 week, eight on off the next week. So you've got the same repetitiveness, but only for 7 weeks as opposed to 14. So you have, say, Wright and Price, the top two in the world, they'll be in different weeks, so you won't see them play until perhaps the semi-finals. So therefore, that builds up a little bit more. So you got Wright and Price, who are the top two in the world, could meet each other in a final, and that builds up a lot of suspense and a lot of momentum. So that could work. Of course, they could get knocked out early doors as well. So there is that. So I think they could experiment with 16 players, because there's a lot of budding players who are doing well on the Pro Tour, and or those like Ryan Searle. They could have had in Dimitri, Jose de Souza, a couple of other players like that, a couple of emerging players, you know, like give them a go, so to speak, and they'd be playing like once every 2 weeks. And it would lighten the schedule for the players, and it will raise a bit more interest for people. And I think that could work a lot better.
We got to give a shout out to Michael Van Gerwen, don't we? He seems to be back at the top of his game.
He seems to be in the European Tour and the Premier League, but the jury's still out if he's going to win any majors this year. I'm suspecting he won't, because I'm still not convinced on him in the big events. I mean, he didn't really do much at the UK Open. He didn't do much at the Masters. I just think he's very beatable, and these type of events suit him better, because he quite likes the 3 matches in 1 day model. So the ITV majors might work for him, but the Sky ones, like the World Match Play, the World Grand Prix, and those two, I don't think he'll win. If he's going to win the TV title, it'll be one of the ITV ones.
One thing you got to say about Michael Motorcycle is that he's built up this big fan base, seems to treat his fans well, and MVG Nation lives and dies by this guy.
They do. I mean, you see a couple of them on Twitter who just live or die by his result every week, even in the Premier League, even on the Pro Tour, European Tour, whatever. Yeah, they're just a bit mad. It's not quite fanatical status yet, but they're getting there. Quite funny.
We've got some odds and ends from the PDC. He's not in the Premier League. Perhaps one day, though. I know you're impressed by this Josh Rock kid. What do you know about him besides that he's putting up some big numbers? I mean, he looks really good. Looks like he's clutch. Looks like he's got it all.
Yeah, he does. He looks superb. I didn't know much about him until I listened to Andrew Sinclair's Inside the WF podcast, and he mentioned him on one of his podcasts, saying he's one to watch out for the Irish Open. So I thought, yeah, okay, we'll have a look at this young player, whatever. Think. And then he got on a stream against Neil Duff, who won the WF World title, and he absolutely battled him with 112 average. And I thought, this guy looks really, really good. And I thought, maybe it's a bit too early for him. Maybe he'd just go on the development tour. Then he went and got a tour card. And, you know, he's posting monster good averages. And he looks a real, 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 real prospect.
Were you watching the floor events the past 2 days? All the big names taking time off. How about that final today? Michael Smith, Callan Ridds, high octane stuff. Bully Boy goes back to back.
Smith needs some wins from somewhere, and he needs some momentum. So this is the ideal thing for him. And with his Premier League buddy, so to speak, not taking part, this is a good chance for him to get 30 grand. So fair play to him. You know, he needs it. He needs a bit of form. He needs a bit of impetus and a bit of momentum. I don't watch much of the Pro Tour because it's on during times where I can't watch it, and I just look at the Dark Connect and I'll look at the scores and everything like that. So yeah, fair play. He's been playing. He looks like he's been playing quite well anyway. So let's see what he does tomorrow and onwards to that.
I'll tell you what, I know you're a fan of the phrase proper darts. That was proper darts that final today. Callan Ridds played well, but Michael Smith, when he's on form, he's just hard to beat sometimes. You mentioned a word there, momentum. Let's discuss that. First of all, I don't play much darts anymore, hardly ever. But back in the day when I was competitive, I can tell you that momentum is a real thing. Winning or losing, if it's happening, you feel it. And sometimes when that ball gets rolling, it's very, very hard to stop. The great ones can stop it, but it's not easy.
No, it's not. You could slip. You could slip for a long time. You look at Glenn Durrant. I mean, you know, he won the Premier League in 2020, got to the World Match Play semifinals in 2020, and his form's fallen off the cliff since. He's only won, I think, three or four matches since then. That's what I mean. His momentum has gone down. He's got the momentum of losing all the time, which is a shame. But momentum is a big factor in sports. Without it, people don't win. I know a certain Sky commentator hates the word momentum. I don't see how you could say that momentum is not focused in sports, because it's something where if you're playing well, you get the momentum to go into the next game and play well there. Get the momentum to go into the next game and play well there. So the momentum is a massive factor in the darts. A person who had loads of great momentum was John O'Shea. He got to the final yesterday and won the World Masters in 2019 based on momentum, because when he was on the roll, the momentum is there. He looks very, 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 very good, but he needs to have the momentum, it looks like, because his B game isn't quite there. So his momentum, he needs to push himself up a level. It works in different ways, momentum, and it's a big word for sport.
Well, a big word for sport, but also a big word for the World Darts Federation these days. I know you hugely support the WDF. Let's talk about the World Championships at the legendary Lakeside. What a spectacle that was, my friend. Martin Adams went out early. A couple of Canadians made a splash, but then fizzled. Cameron Menzies got to the semis, but lost. Thibaut Tricol, a trailblazer of French darts. Neil Duff won the men's. Bo Greaves, the women's. Wasn't meant to be for Dita Hedman, but what a worlds it was. It had everything, including drama.
It was great, and I think Richard Ashdown and Nick Rolls will probably think it's gone better than they thought it would do in their dream, because there was a time where I thought this may flop because the crowds won't come in, and people might just say, well, in the middle of April, stop that, and so forth. But it gained momentum. There was a great deal of interest of people. It was reported well by the guys within the darting community, who gave it the respect it deserved. It was a fantastic tournament. I mean, you had these record-breaking averages. You had young players dominating. You had young players playing well, like Luke Littler, Bo Greaves, obviously. Bo Greaves winning it at the age of 18, looking like the best lady dart player in the world. It was just a great tournament, and thank God it happened, and thank God it wasn't the disaster of 2020. Not the playing side, but I'm on the organisation, because everybody was saying how the organisation was first class and professional, and that's what it's needed, and that's what it deserves. If it's got a professional setup, then the players will be more comfortable about playing in it. And once the players both play in it, they produce better averages. Once they produce better averages on TV, it improves the product. So the product gets better. WDF have more events. So everything flows in one direction. So WDF is needed for the so-called amateur, even though I don't really like that term. It just needs a bit more marketing, which I think the WDF grasps at the end. And we got a sellout crowd for the final. So it was brilliant. I enjoyed it.
I found it riveting from start to finish. I watched it all, and it was so nice to see the players back at the legendary Lakeside, those fans, that stage, so close together. You can feel the tension, and you can appreciate the atmosphere. Terrific atmosphere.
Oh, it is. It's just so weird when you get in there. It's just like everything's so close, and you just think, wow, this is the Lakeside. You do get that feeling. It's like you know, when players say they like their spine goes, you know, the spine tingles a little bit. You do get that feeling when you get there. I've been there like 10, 11 times, and I still think, wow, this is Lakeside. This is where loads of players, great players, played. and loads of great players will play. So it's been superb. And Neil Duff was a worthy winner. I thought he played consistent for that tournament. I thought Richard Venstra showed if he could package that, he'll be a force in the future. But he needs to package what he's got. Bo Graves, superb, worthy winner. Kirsty Hutchinson was superb. I predicted her to get to the final. See, I actually got a prediction right there.
I was really impressed by Hutchinson. I mean, she gave it some on stage. She was competitive, fiery. She was there to win.
Yes, she was. She was very good to see, and she took advantage of the so called lesser half of the draw. And put some good wins together against Rhiannon O'Sullivan. She played really, really well. She was worthy finalist. Of course, Bo destroyed her, because Bo would have destroyed anybody that day. She was in the women's circuit because she was superb. Her ceiling, as everybody keeps saying, her ceiling is higher than Lisa and Fallon's. So she can get further and further within the game than them two. It's just mad, really.
I was in awe of the way she played, especially in that final, highest average in finals history at the Lakeside. I mean, what a brilliant performance. You talk about momentum. That world championship carries on, and look what happened at the Welsh Open, the Welsh Classic. Great stream. Luke Littler, you mentioned, he had a great event. Fallon Sherrick as well. And of course, Bo. Run it down for us. I mean, loads of action highlighted by that fascinating women's final, Graves versus Sherrick.
Oh, that was a great final. I was watching the stream and saw Fallon go through and up, and I thought, Fallon's going to win this one. I think fair play to her. She's just dominated Bo Graves, and questions answered, really. Then I saw it 3-0. I thought, God almighty. And then I saw, take out that 1-5-8. I thought, and the averages were just like in the 90s, and I think they would have climbed if it was another 6 or 7 legs. So it's just great that they're both exceptional players, and they're both produce something for the Welsh crowd. It's great. The Welsh crowd is great because I've been there a few times, and it's always a good setup there, and all that. And also Wes Newton getting to the final for the first time in, I think it's about 12 years. About 8 years, sorry, not 12. 8 years, and he got to the final against Luke Littler, and you got Barry Copeland, who won as well. So some good worthy winners in Wales, and it was professionally run, and it was a great stream.
Now, you tweeted out before that ladies' final, hopefully Bo will beat Fallon. Why did you tweet that?
Yeah. Well, it's because the reason why I tweeted that, because the winner of the Welsh Open gets an automatic Lakeside place. Now, we know that the last 2 years that Fallon has withdrew from Lakeside for her own reasons, and my tweet was to say that it would be wasted, because I think she would withdraw again, because she'll be in the PDC World Championship, because I can't see anybody catching Lisa and Fallon in the women's series. So it was just more of a continuity type of thing, rather than a slight. I'd rather Fallon did play in the WF4 Championships, but there's obviously something there that she can't. So it was more of a come on, Bo, we need to get the place in, to fulfil the place, so to speak, even though she was already qualified. That was it, really.
In fairness, you then tweeted out after the match, after everyone was left just with their jaws dropped, what a great final. Yeah. That was a wonderful match between Bo and Fallon. Excellent standard throughout, you said. Massive shot in the arm for ladies' darts.
It was. What you need is ladies' final to be two people trying to rip each other apart. And that's what they both did, really. I mean, for how good Bo was in the Lakeside final, because he couldn't reach that standard. Fallon can reach that standard, so it was a great final, and you need more competitive finals. I'm sure there will be in the future as well, between all sorts of different players. But But competitive finals at a high standard is what Lady Darts needs.
You mentioned the 1.58 to make it 4-4. That was just clutch. She also took out a 1.25. Yeah. And in the final leg, the decider with Fallon on a double, she took out 62 on a last dart. It was terrific. By the way, I got to say cheers for that Trina Gulliver-Frances Henselaar video, the 1999 World Masters final. I watched it. High, high quality as well. Thanks for that recommendation. Yeah. It's worth the watch.
Not a problem, because I was thinking people might just say, "Oh, that's the best standard of all time." So I was ready for it was Trina versus Frances in 1999, but nobody did. So everybody's just saying, "What a great match!" It was a great match. So there it is, and so it's all good. But Trina versus Frances is a great watch as well. That was a great rivalry, but back in those days, nobody really cared about Lady Darts, which was a shame, because Trina was superb and Frances was very good as well. And thankfully now, the interest in Lady Darts is excellent. And because 10, 12 years ago, there was a petition went round to show even ladies' first round games at Lakeside by the BBC. We've come a long way from that. And it's good for ladies' darts.
Well, it was a great final. I'll tell you what, Frances was clutch on those finishing doubles. She scored well too. They both meant business. And you talk about the camaraderie at the end of it—a big hug. But Trina definitely dominated those times. Great win there for Frances. Thank you again for that. Yeah. Lastly, Aki, people want to know this. I want to know your philosophy on social media. Why do you clash with so many people? Do you consider yourself the voice of reason on Twitter, the voice of common sense? Why so many verbal jousting matches, my friend, in 280 characters or less? Why?
There's a few reasons why. One, because I like a good debate. I may lose the debate, and I've lost plenty. Two, sometimes I by my own character, like to rip up the hornet's nest a little bit. Yeah, again, it's just, half the time I'm just laughing, you know, like the things with the debate with the Wade and Barney thing. We're just laughing at that, really. It's just, but we mean what we say, but we're just, you know, using it in a joking manner. Sometimes there's stuff on politics and stuff on darts, football, cricket, where I think that's not right, or I don't agree with that. This is what I think, and it sometimes causes into that. Sometimes I bring other people, try and bring other people into the debate, saying, "What do you think of this?" So to speak. So yeah, I do whip up the order's nest. I can't really deny that. Sometimes I do it mischievously, and I agree. A lot of people are used to that now within a diet community. They go, Aki's having a go again. We'll just wait for him to finish, and then we'll just carry on with our lives. They know. So it's all good fun. I mean, I've never really taken anything that seriously on Twitter. It's just like, if people think, "Oh, your opinion's wrong, Aki, you're stupid," and everything, I just think, well, that's their opinion, and fair play to them for that. And a lot of people have said that, and I've blocked one guy for a bit of bounce, that's it. But I don't really block, I found it on and off, but I don't really block anybody else, really. I don't think blocking is the way to go on Twitter. So yeah, it's just a bit of fun, really.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm a big fan. I follow you, and proudly, my friend. Darts Twitter, this guy's the governor. At It's Aki again on Twitter. The Rocky of Darts, Aki Balboa. Chris, thanks, pal. A pleasure as always, man.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much for having me on.